This is a wonderful conference for bringing attention back to this issue. And I want to start this morning by just describing what would happen as the direct effects of a Ramadi nuclear war. We're all familiar with the image of Hiroshima after the nuclear bombing there. And we have to understand this is not what the world will look like after modern nuclear war. Hiroshima was one small bomb, about 15 kilotons, 15,000 tons of TNT. A modern attack on a city like Boston would involve not one bomb, but perhaps 10 or 12, each of them anywhere from 10 to 50 times more powerful than the bomb that destroyed Hiroshima. It's difficult to describe 10 or 15 bombs going off all at the same time, so I'm going to use a model of a single explosion, a single 20 megaton bomb, 20 million tons of TNT. The megatonnage is actually a little bit bigger than would probably fall on Boston. The destruction that I'm going to describe is actually an underestimate because you cause more damage by spreading out the bombs over more efficiently over a large area. But I think it gives an adequate understanding of the magnitude of the danger that we face. So a 20 megaton bomb going off over the Statehouse in downtown. Within 1/1000th of a second, a fireball would form, reaching out for 2 miles in every direction, engulfing everything, including the building we're sitting in a fireball, which the temperatures within this would rise to up to 20 million degrees Fahrenheit, which is hotter than the surface of the sun, and everything would be vaporized. The buildings, the people, the trees, the upper level of the earth itself would disappear. To a distance of 4 miles in every direction, the blast would generate overpressures of 25 pounds per square inch and winds in excess of 600 miles per hour. Mechanical forces of that magnitude could destroy anything that people could build. Underground shelters collapse when they're exposed to pressures this great. To a distance of 6 miles in every direction, the heat would be so intense that automobiles would melt. To a distance of 10 miles in every direction, or out now to the 128 Beltway, the winds would still be greater than 200 miles per hour. The blast pressure is still greater than 10 pounds per square inch. Forces of that magnitude will level masonry buildings, wooden frame buildings. A building like this would see the walls and the floors swept out. There'd be a steel skeleton left behind. To a distance of 16 miles in every direction, and note I've had to change the scale of the map to accommodate this zone of destruction. To a distance of 16 miles in every direction, the heat would still be so intense that everything flammable would burn. Paper, cloth, gasoline, wood, heating oil, plastic, it would all ignite, causing hundreds of thousands of fires, which over the next half hour would coalesce into a firestorm, 32 miles across, covering over 800 square miles. Within this entire area, the temperatures would rise to 1,400 degrees Fahrenheit. All of the oxygen would be consumed, and every living thing would die. In the case of Boston, we're talking about something in the order of 3 million people dead in a half an hour. Beyond this firestorm, the destruction would continue. To a distance of 19 miles, people standing outside would suffer third-degree burns on any exposed skin. To a distance of 21 miles, second-degree burns. To a distance of 40 miles, people who turned reflexively to look at the sudden flash of light would be blinded. There would be hundreds of thousands of casualties, all kinds of injuries. People blinded, as I mentioned. People made deaf by having their eardrums ruptured. People suffering penetrating wounds as shards of glass flew through the air. People with mechanical injuries and crush injuries from being thrown themselves through the air or being trapped under collapsing buildings. And most especially, there would be people with burns. Tens, if not hundreds of thousands of people with major brain injuries. They would all need urgent medical attention, and that care would not be available. In the entire United States, there are about 2,000 burn beds. Here in the Boston area, there are 3 institutions, between them 46 burn beds for hundreds of thousands of patients. And all 3 of these facilities are in the zone of complete destruction. In fact, almost all of the hospitals in the metropolitan area would be destroyed. Most of the doctors would be dead. Most of the nurses would be dead. There'd be no electricity to power EKG machines, x-ray machines. what few little supplies were not destroyed, blood products, antibiotics, pain medicine, would be used up in the first minutes of dealing with this catastrophe. There'd be no EMS system to transport people to the hospital. And in fact, the vast majority of the people who were injured would also die. And if this attack were part of a large-scale war between the United States and Russia, this same level of destruction would be visited on every major city in both countries. A study which we published in 2002 showed that if only 300 of the 1,500 warheads that the Russians maintain on hair trigger alert hit urban targets in the United States, 75 to 100 million people would be dead in the first half hour. In addition, the entire economic infrastructure of the country would be destroyed. All the things that we depend on to maintain our population. We're not hunter-gatherers or subsistence farmers. We need an intact society to live, and that society would be gone. The internet would be gone, the electric grid, the public health system, the food distribution system. None of this would exist anymore. And it is probable that in the months following this nuclear war, the vast majority of the American and Russian people who did not die in the initial attack would also die from exposure, from starvation, from radiation poisoning, from epidemic illness. All told, perhaps a half a billion people. Right? And as my colleague, Professor Robach, will explain in his talk, these direct effects are only a part, and incredibly enough, only a small part of the damage that we caused by nuclear war. So why talk about this? Well, for two reasons. First, because if we do not take action, this is the future that will be. This is going to happen. We've been told for 25 years that we don't need to worry about nuclear war between the United States and Russia. Well, even during that period, we knew that there could be an accident. And there have been at least five occasions since the early 1980s when either Moscow or Washington prepared to launch nuclear war in mistaken belief that it was already under attack. But in the last two or three years, we've also come to understand that the assurances we received that deliberate nuclear war between the US and Russia was impossible, those assurances were hollow.